Well, how do you get this insurance? How do you know that you are saved? Well, first, in order to know that you have it, you first have to get it.
Yes, right.
I wish I had somebody praying in here.
Right.
You first have to get saved in order to know that you are saved. And so I got 2 points for you and we're going to go home. First of all, there is the acquisition of salvation. In other words, we have to first get it in order to keep it. And have, are you praying with me?
Yeah.
And in order to have it, I first need to get it.
Yeah.
How does a person get saved? I'm glad you asked. It's a good question. 1 John chapter 5, verse 1 says, whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God.
Yeah.
And everyone that loveth him that begat, loving him also that he is begotten of him.
All right.
And so salvation, in other words, is acquired by belief in the person of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Let me say that again. Salvation is acquired by belief in the person of Jesus Christ.
Right.
Amen. Amen. That he is, in fact, the promised Messiah.
All right.
In other words, I believe that he is the one that God throughout the pages of history and the pages of the Bible prophesied would come.
Yes.
That he is the Messiah that is promised in the Bible.
Right.
Belief that he is in fact the Son of God.
Yes.
Belief in fact that he is the Savior of the world.
Yes.
That's why the Gospel of John chapter 1 verses 11 and 12 says, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Even to them that believe on his name. How do I get it? I have to believe in the person of Jesus Christ. But belief is not just mental assent to who Jesus is. It's not just mental assent to the facts of who Christ is.
Right.
But the Bible tells us that the demons in hell know that Jesus is the Christ.
All right.
The devil knows that there is one God. So to say that we just believe in God is not enough in order to be saved. But belief is not just mental assent in the facts of who he is, but it is total faith in the absolute trust in who he is unto salvation. That's why Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 and 9 says, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. For by grace are we saved. Salvation comes not on the basis of our actions, but on the basis of your faith in the actions of Jesus Christ. Because he died on Calvary's cross in order to pay for your sins and mine. He rose from the grave on the third day in order to seal our redemption and a new life in him. And so what I'm telling you is, I'm not saved because I've been holy. I'm not saved because I've done righteously. Jesus has done for us. That's it. I can't depend on the best 5 minutes of my life in order to be acceptable by God. Somebody say, what are you talking about? See, because if you're like me, and I know that you're probably better than me, but if you're like me, I can only give 5 minutes of acceptable service at a time. I'm good for 5 minutes to do the right thing for 5 minutes. That's all I'm good for. After 5 minutes, my mind goes on stuff, and I go to thinking about stuff that ain't, come on, somebody. You don't have to look at me funny. You ain't got but about 5 to 10 minutes either. You're doing something you ain't got no business, or thinking something you ain't. But the best 5 minutes, if you could just do it for 5 minutes, and if 5 minutes of acceptable behavior could get you into heaven, you still wouldn't be able to get into heaven. Come on, somebody. But it's by the grace of God saved. Come on, somebody. I'm not saved on the basis of anything that I have done, but on the basis of what Christ has done for me. Yeah. Faith, I'm struggling with trying to be able to put faith in an illustration that will help us to understand faith and grace working together in order to save us. Faith. Grace is God doing for us what we don't deserve. Grace is God finding us, not us finding him. Grace is God reaching out to us, not us reaching out to him. Grace is God coming down to see about us in our filthy and wretched condition. What God did was he reached down and he said to me one day, I love you and I want to save you. And there was nothing that I was doing. Matter of fact, I was doing everything to cause an opposite response from God. But grace was God reaching down into my filthiness and saying, I love you and I want to save you. Faith is me reaching back up to God and saying, God, I believe what you say and I want your salvation. That's what faith is. And so if God reached down to you one day and said, I love you and I want to save you, and you in order to receive him.
Yes.
But because he chose us,
all
we have to do is accept him by faith and to trust in Jesus alone, the only means of salvation.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Because there is no more than one way
to
be saved. Hear me now.
Yes.
It's not grace and your works. It's not faith and other stuff. It's just faith in Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Right.
Can I impress that upon you?
Yes.
That's how we acquire salvation. And trusting in him only for salvation. Nothing else, no other thing, no other prescription will be able to heal your sin sickness. Jesus and him alone. Come on, somebody. That's the acquisition of salvation. But then there's also the assurance of salvation that we go home. The assurance of salvation helps us to know that we have salvation in Christ Jesus.
All right.
John writes this book so we will know that we are saved. He writes it so to assure believers that what you have is a genuine article.
Yes, sir.
That's why he wrote it. That's why he wrote this letter. And he uses the word know, K-N-O-W.
Yes.
He uses it almost 40 times in this short epistle. And he did that because God wants you to know you're saved.
All right.
He wants you to live saved. He wants you to live with the confidence and the assurance that comes only from a faith and a genuine relationship with him through his son Jesus Christ. And through this, the course of this book, he gives us illustrations and he gives us these principles to help us to leave from this experience with an assurance that we are saved.
Yes.
And he gives us three basic tests that will help us to know and determine whether or not we have been born again.
All right.
First of all, he gives us the lordship test. Amen. We all gonna take a test today. He gives us the lordship test. The lordship test is Jesus. Ask the question: is Jesus the Lord of your life?
Yes. Right.
That's the lordship test. Who's in control of you?
All right.
Amen. Amen. 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 says, "And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that said, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him." I can't make make this up. It's right there in the Bible.
All right.
In the heart of every believer, there will be a desire to do the will of God. The person who could care less about God and the things of God is not saved.
Amen.
Can I say that again to you, sister? If the brother don't care about God and the things of God, he ain't saved.
Right.
I don't care what he tell you. I don't care what church you go to. If he don't care about God and godliness, he is not saved. Are you praying with me? Yeah. But the person who is truly born again will have as his heart's desire the desire and the will to obey and please God. He or she may become distracted, like many of us do. He or she may even get off course, like many of us do. But there is this desire on the inside that won't allow you to be off course and be satisfied. And that will move you and push you and prod you and poke you till you get back on the course that God has designed for you. Amen, amen. He or she may be distracted, but after a while, they'll get back where they belong. Yeah, yeah. He or she, I wish I had a witness in here. I know I ain't the only one who's afraid of me. I know I'm not the only one who got away from the things that God wanted for my life and desired in my life. And I've gotten off the right course. But by the grace of God, there was something on the inside that would not leave me alone. Would not give me peace until I got it right. That's a person who has really been born again.
Yeah.
Are you praying with me?
Yeah.
Not perfect in any way.
Yeah.
I don't have it all together by no means.
Yeah.
But there is an underlying desire to do the will of God. Are you praying with me?
Yeah.
Saints are not saved by keeping his commandments.
Yeah.
But we are saved. And we are marked by the desire to please the Lord.
Yes.
So all I'm saying, that's the lordship test. But it is also the fellowship test.
Uh-huh. All right.
1 John chapter 3, verse 14. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren.
All right.
He that loveth his brother abideth. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. If you're saved, there will be a genuine love for God's people.
Amen.
Amen. It's no sense in people trying to tell you that I'm saved, I love the Lord, but I don't need nobody else.
All right.
Just me and God. I don't need no church. There is no such thing as a Christian who does not worship.
Yes, sir. All right.
There is no such thing as a body part that can thrive without the rest of the body.
Right.
Amen. You go, God forbid, something, you cut something off.
All right.
Amen. Or the doctors cut something off of your body. That's the end of it. All
right.
Amen. Unless they attach it real quick. Amen. It's done. It's dead. Are you praying with me? And there's no such thing as a believer that is unattached to the rest of the body of Jesus Christ.
Right.
The fellowship test says that if I'm really saved, that I love God's people.
Yeah.
And love characterizes the life of a true Christian. Are y'all praying with me?
Yeah.
Amen. Now, that doesn't mean that I just love them when everything is well in our relationship. Doesn't mean that we don't struggle and have strife with one another sometimes. But ultimately, I'm back to the characterization that separates me from the world and makes sure and shows that I am genuinely a part of the character of Jesus Christ. And that is that we love one another. 1 John chapter 4, verse 20 and 21 says, if a man say, I love God and hated his brother, he is a liar.
Amen.
I ain't making this up. It's right there in the word. For he that loveth not his brother whom he had seen, how can he love God whom he had not seen? And this commandment have we from him that he who loveth God love his brother also. All I've been trying to say is that love characterizes the life of a true believer. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 8 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God, and knoweth God. But he that loveth not, knoweth not God. For God is love." True believers love the brethren. True believers love the rest of the family. True believers love other believers.
Yes.
And desire their fellowship. You can't tell me you love me if you never want to see me. Come on, somebody. You can't tell me you love me and you never want to be in my presence. You can't tell me you love me and every time you see me, you avoiding me. Come on, somebody. True believers love one another.